Let me start. Again, thank you everybody for coming. Since we last spoke, the tax court has announced the actual day of the exam. So I encourage everybody to, register for the exam early. Last year, we had some people who had studied for the whole time who mailed in their applications on the last day and got back. The postmark rule doesn't apply. It has to be received by, right? Tongue in cheek, that was the response. If you didn't get that part right, you can't even take the exam. So, the earlier the better. For those of you who want us to be your sponsor for the exam, just come see me and you can have us as your sponsors for the exam. So that's out there.
People have asked questions about the process for admission. Mary has agreed to answer questions.
If those of you can't hear Jeff, people have questions about the process for admission. Mary Sunderland passed from our last class, and she'll go through it all with you. Anyone who's interested in those types of questions, either email Mary or come see her at, when she's at our offices for taxpayer assistance. So anyone interested in those processes, those of you who come to the calendar call, Mary and Diane have been at the calendar call, they've entered their appearances already, they've filed tax court petitions. So it is real, right? And it doesn't end with just passing the exam. We're gonna stay with you to try one or two cases so that you feel like you've gotten on the, real supervision of doing trials, right? So it doesn't stop. You come to the calendar calls, you help, you watch, you meet the judges, you become part of the tax controversy community, right? Any other comments that you wanted to make on that? All right, next, what else do we want to go through? Questions of the day. I'm telling you, read one. We're trying to post one question every day for everybody. Read them. If you don't think that the answer is right or you have questions, please, email the rest of the class. We're all learning from each other, right? And that's the best thing to get you closer to passing. Write. Right. We just had the first set of practice exams, and now this weekend there'll be the second set of practice exams. And one of the things we're seeing is handwriting can cause you to lose points. So print. Don't use script. Two, on the questions of the day. We're at the point where, in addition to reading your questions of the day, you should start taking a practice exam and write out one question every day, right? Many of you are not used to handwriting long documents anymore. Whether it was on a practice exam that you were cramping up or it was just taking you too long, you need to start creating the muscle memory again to handwrite for 4 solid hours. Right, those of you who took the practice exam, right? One, that 4 hours moved so quickly. Right? Didn't it feel like you just started and then it was we telling you you put the pen down, it's done? Right. Two, you're cramping up. So little mechanical things. Then three, if you're not taking the practice exam under the test conditions in the office, take the exams and then what you get wrong. We're posting, answer grids, right? The answer grids that we're using to grade everybody. Grade yourself. And then you focus on the code section questions on prior exams that deal with the same code sections. If you look on the group, I've posted a chart, and then in all the materials, you'll start seeing that every time a code section is tested in the past exams. If you got a question on the code section wrong, go and answer for yourselves the prior exams. I am posting a grid, right? If you see, we've done a chart of all the prior exams by code section. Don't cheat. do the answer, try to do the answer first, and then compare it to the chart, right? Because then you'll know, the next practice exam you take, you got that code section question right. You know, we can move on and focus on the other questions. We're not going for 100% on every section. You get 70% on every section and you've passed. As you can see, they repeat many of the same code sections, right? Section 101 has been on the last four exams. So that's gonna be one of the sections that we're gonna focus on. If you see, everything we're on tonight is gonna cover questions that have been on the prior exams, questions that have been in the tax court cases of recently, because those are the questions that if you're able to answer, you're gonna be able to use them to pass the exam. And also, they are questions that come up in everyday practice. So I want to counsel everybody who really wants to pass, and everybody's putting in time, to look at the questions of the day, take the practice exams, and then focus on the charts that we're creating. Look at those questions. And I'm gonna keep encouraging everybody, but write something every day. One question, don't spend more than 15 minutes. It tells you on the question how much time you get in real life circumstance, right? So keep yourself to that time. Some questions are 1 minute, some questions are 5 minutes. The longest question is 15 minutes. So don't spend more than the 15 minutes, but do it every day. Yes?
Because one of the things I think we continually get confused and broken over is if you're putting exam questions in there from prior years, what answer do we give? The answer that
is what I've started to do. Now, if whoever's taking this weekend's practice exam, I've pushed all the dates forward to 2016 and cross-checked all the code sections so that when you take the exam, you're really taking it under today's real-life experience. What? Yes?
No, it's a compliment. Something I want to... I don't think people realize it, that if there's a calculation, like alimony, some of the depreciations, they actually have the link on there to someone's website that you could change the numbers and press the button, and you can check yourself.
Right. I'm giving you the ability, the links on... if you. Those of you who look at question of the day, the top link is always to the code section itself so that you can read the code section. Then near the bottom or suggested reading would be the case that the question is based off of, right? Most of the questions in either the procedure section and the substance section come from real cases. The judges are looking at the backgrounds. Okay. So what I'm trying to do, when I know that it's an actual case that was the genesis of the fact pattern, and I know this very painfully because four of my cases that I lost were on the last test, right? So it seemed like the judge was following and just put the losses on. Judges, if you're on here, I'd like you to put the wins on next time. They're based on real cases that were tried and that you can see on question of the day, on the tax court case of the day. That's why I'm telling you all to read the cases that come out every day at 3:30, because the judges frequently look at the cases they've just decided. They're fresh in their mind when they're writing the questions for the exam. So there is a high probability that something decided in the last 2 years will be on. Like last week in question of the day that I forwarded was the Gorowman case, where they said that one, the tax court doesn't recognize equitable tolling, but two, the fact that there was a snow day and DC was closed meant that you treated the same as a holiday. If I were a betting man, I would bet that will be on the exam this year. Yes, one more question, because then we got to get a lot of stuff.
I appreciate what you said, because it is true, they don't look at that. But on the bottom of the page, the people that write it actually have someone else's website, and on there it's like a calculator. So if you change numbers and you're going from year to year, you can put it in the calculator after you wrote it out, and you can check it. And that is a really great tool.
Those are your double checks. I don't want you to rely on calculators, because you don't get to use them in the exam, but I've given you the ability, right, when we edit the work that's been done by, you know, the students who I'm not gonna introduce, where I'm giving you the ability to study it on your own, to verify every answer, to know it, right? And again, if we do one thing a day between now and the exam, you will have learned everything that will be tested on the exam. Yes, Jeff?
Just if you could remind people that are coming on Saturday to bring their own code books for the people on that.
Right, okay. For the people taking the test on Saturday, we don't have enough codes, so if you can bring your own internal revenue code to the exam, all right? There will be blue books, yes?
I think today is a good idea, but it's too early.
See, it's not, see, this is my thought process of what I am seeing. I don't care that some people got 50s, right? Because I know that I'm gonna increase your score 10 points every month. I also know from teaching other people, I used to teach people.
Get demoralized, you get depressed.
See, that's what I'm saying. I'm the cheerleader, don't be depressed, all right? Nobody should be depressed. A 50 means all we gotta do is get 20 more points in 4 months to pass.
That's the thing, the 20 marginal point, that's what.
I'm gonna get, if you do what I'm telling you to do, because we're gonna focus on what you don't know as opposed to what you know. If you got the questions right, I'm not giving you homework on what you're getting right. I'm pushing everybody to where they're getting it wrong. So that between now and then, and what I have found, look, I've prepped people for exams before, right? And I know that repetition, SAT question of the day is what graded, you know, got, I have 9 nieces and nephews that have all worked for me, right? And all of them have question of the day on the SAT prep. They think that I don't care, I don't talk to them. If they haven't done their question of the day, they can't even talk to me. Can I ask you a question? No. You can't ask Uncle Frank a question until you tell me what question of the day was. All right, you do that, and then the writing of the practice. Again, what we're seeing, and it was bared out by the first exam, it's you didn't finish because of the time pressure. You gotta learn the speed, right? Each of these questions, you know, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, but if you're answering them now, and you're not ready, and you haven't tried it through, I see people dwelling. Like, there are people who did not finish the exam. You know, on the first, they got through half of the exam, and what they did, they were on par to pass. I mean, to score everything. But then they had to zero out for the sections that they never even got to. So, again, it's all optional for everybody. By looking at an exam and reading the exam and putting in the score sheets, it's how we're gonna know what you don't know so we can help you get to yes. And that's there, like I said, there's lots of people in the office who want to help everybody get to yes. And this is the time to introduce everybody. Now, you've been reading questions a day by different people. You know, Karen Zahn and Mike Wallace have been answering questions of the day from the 2012 and 2014 exams, right? Reva and Emma have been working on the older years exams. Patrick, who's not here, and Rob, who's in the back, has also been working on the evidence sections of the exam. So there are people who are working on the different sections of the exam: evidence, substance, ethics, practice and procedure, and working on those questions a day and prepping those grids that we have been sending out, right? So what we're gonna do today is have each of them do one of the questions or a group of questions on the sections that they've been working on and have sent out to you. So this is gonna, if you've read the outlines, it's a little different. We incorporated the examples, the exam questions, and the examples right into the materials, so that we're gonna go with the IRAC method, which is the method that they use in law school. Issue, rule, application, conclusion, right? Because if you learn it that way, then you will be able to think through any variations that they put on the exam. Issue, rule, application, conclusion, IRAC, okay? Now, one last fun thing. We do an annual barbecue. Some of you have come last year, right? The marching band, the food trucks, the whole bit. Our annual barbecue this year is June 22nd. You're all invited. And before the barbecue, there is our civil and criminal international tax enforcement update, right? And there are people from, you know, the best firms in the country. Brian Scarlatus, there are people from the Hockman firm, Charles Reddick and Steve Tosher, Rich Sapinski. We're gonna, for those of you doing offshore voluntary disclosures, from all those of you who've seen that, we have more and more clients who have international obligations, whether they have family abroad. We're gonna try to give you an update about what's been going on at the Internal Revenue Service, how they're gonna do that. So that's on June 22nd. All right, so now let's start. We're gonna go with, group them first, the questions on estate and gift tax, right? There are things that we should all know. Every journeyman preparer, every young attorney should know a little about estate and gift tax, the common issues that come up. And on this section, Mike Wallace is going to be like my straight man, because he's going to be answering the hard questions. Yeah, all right? Section 101, you know, insurance and death benefits. Four exams in a row. So you got to know. They always test about 101. Before we go over this, all right? Life insurance, taxable or not?
No.
All right, most of the time, the answer is, what about if you take it over time? And you're gonna get interest on the life insurance.
It's taxable.
Okay. Remember those general rules, because then we're gonna go through the questions. Capital, which is the, you know, the proceeds of the insurance policy, generally gonna be non-taxable. Interest, payment for the use of money, is gonna be taxable. And that theme goes through insurance. That theme is going to go through installment sale. That theme goes through many of the sections of the code, right? Income doesn't include a return of your principal. Payments for the cost of money, for the use of your money, is generally going to be treated as interest and taxable. That theme should go throughout everything we do. All right, so the general rule, life insurance, if it's paid by reason of the death of the insured, is not taxable to the recipient, right? General rule on the questions, right? Why is it? That's what the code section says. I mean, there's constitutional considerations. Again, you don't tax principal. You tax the accretions to the wealth. You tax the use of money, all right? So life insurance is defined by the code. It's defined by section 101F, and it's also in 7702. So proceeds of a life insurance on the death of another are generally non-taxable for the questions. All right, so how we're gonna get here. I wanna get us to the questions. So the important things are that it's gotta be a real life insurance policy, and the payment has to be by reason of death. The policies pay on death. Interest or the payment that results from the investment of the policy proceeds are generally going to be taxable, right? So remember the general rules, all right? So then there's, how do they come up? Is it a true tax benefit? So the creditor purchases life insurance on the life of the debtor. So if the debtor dies before paying off his debt, right, the policy can go to pay off the debt. The payment in the hands of the creditor isn't the life insurance, it's paying for the debt. It's not paid by reason of death, right? That's a nuance, all right? There's gonna be lots of examples here. Except transfers of life insurance can get you in trouble. They don't test this, but the transfer of life insurance, which
you
might
hear me in the back.
You can or can't hear me in the
back? Cannot.
All right, let's go.
The
apparently the lobby there is not working, so you guys can't really hear me. All right.
If it works, you just have to be closer to the mic.
I've got to be closer to the mic. Okay. So then, interest is includable. All right. Again, payment of life insurance debt later than death. The deferral of the payment. If it increases the amount of money that you're paying, is how you, is going to be the interest. So if you can take your money over at debt, and then there's an increased amount because you're taking it later, that's how you calculate the tax, right? The bonus or the premium for taking it later is generally paid to you because the insurance company is going to invest your money. That's the definition of interest.
What was the title
of? Again, that's going to be an in, that's going to, well, you, they never test that, but that's a different type of contract, right? Because these are guaranteed insurance contracts. There's a payment of the premium, then they're giving you more because you're taking it over, you know, 20 years instead of at debt.
Articles. We're not life insurance. They do test 50,000 less group insurance policy.
What is always tested on the exam? If your employer provides you with group insurance and pays the premium, and the face amount of the premium is 50,000 or less, is that taxable?
No.
What if it's 100,000?
Yes. Only on the second 50,000.
The amount above the 50.
On the excess.
All right. That's the excess. That's that's going to be tested.
All right.
So, let's go to the question. You got $100,000 lump sum proceeds on the life of the father. The father purchased the policy, all right? The proceeds are payable to the taxpayer. $100,000, lump sum. Mike Wallace, how much of this? You're doing the return. I told you, dad kicked it. We got $100,000 premium. What do I mean, a lump sum benefit. How much is on the return?
Zero.
Zero.
Under section 101A.
You sure?
Yes. That's my final answer.
Then you passed one question, my boss. Okay.
Got 38 to go.
You got 38 to go. You see, it takes, all it takes is one right and then you build on the next one. We're getting closer to 70. That's right. 101A, my boss. You are correct. That is what I call the general rule. The lump sum payment by reason of death is non-taxable. You're going to pass that question. Next question. $10,000 payment proceeds of the life insurance policy in the face of $20,000, right? Pursuant to the term of the policy, TP elected to receive $10,000 each year for 25 years. All right, Mike Wallace. How much of that $10,000 is income to me in
2014?
2014,
zero.
No.
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 Well, no,
it's
Mike
be
Wallace. 10 over 200,000 times five.
No, don't do that.
Online.
No.
200 over 250.
Online, good shot, right? What did I tell you? Calculate out what would you get at debt. The difference between the two is going to be the taxable income. You weigh it against, what did they give you? They gave you the taxpayer's life expectancy. And they gave it a face amount, right? So you've got everything you need to calculate the difference. All right?
Can I comment on that? Frank?
Yes, but we got to...
I don't know, very quickly. Everyone makes it these crazy division things. You take the $200,000 house, divide it by 25, kick the amount out. That's 1 year's payment. Then see what the fixed rate is, which is 10,000. The difference is the interest. Because the fractions screw you up, Frank. I'm sorry to hear.
No, that is... That's exactly how you would do it, right? You take a look at the life, they're giving you the even numbers. So you divide the number of the insurance above the 25 years, then, so that gives you that the $8,000 would have been the payment, right? Then the difference between the $8,000 and the other is what they're paying you to use your money. That's the $2,000. So, Mike Wallace, the answer to the question would have been $2,000 is taxable, all right? So Mike is still at 50%. We're not passing yet, Mike, because we got to get to 70. So by the time this is, now Reva and Emma are looking at me. Is he going to really do this to us now tonight?
Of course.
I learned. Mike Wallace has it down. What happens every day when you walk into my office, Mike Wallace?
You asked me a question of the day.
Question of the day from the exam. All right, so now we go to the next question, right? So that's on four exams in a row. So section 101, and you're gonna know the question. And you get the shortcut answer is, take the life expectancy, divide it into the face amount of the insurance. The difference in that annual payment is how much they're looking as interest income for you to pay tax on. All right, that's your shorthand. That's the multiplication you do to get to the right answer. Next, gifts and inheritances. Okay, wow, 2004, 6, 8, 10, 12, and 14. They asked this question. So we should know section 102. Section 102, gross income does not include money that you get as a gift, money that you get as a bequest, right, from somebody who died, a devise, that means it's real estate, or an inheritance. Okay. So, on the other hand, what do they owe? Income that's generated by the gift, bequest, devise, or inheritance is taxable. Same thing, right? They don't tax the principal. They don't tax the capital, but they tax the earnings on the capital, right? So principal, interest, tree, fruit, right? Lucas versus Earl, right? You tax the tree, you tax the fruit from the tree, you don't tax the tree, right? If you think about how, like, the general common law principles of taxation, Lucas versus Earl was one of the first cases, and it's your guiding principle. You don't tax capital, right? If you already have capital, you have $1 million. Are you taxed every year on your $1 million? No.
Not yet.
What are they taxing you on? The interest and the earnings on the $1 million. So that's the same type of thing. They're not taxing you on the inheritance. They're not taxing you on the gift. But to the extent you take that money and you make money, then that is taxable. Right? So remember the general rules. So, one of the things that does get tested is, if you work for me, right, and I make a payment to you, is that a gift?
No.
Can an employer give a gift to an employee?
No.
Yes.
Non-taxable fringe, which is going to be tested later, below the certain amounts. Other than that, section 102 says income. Right, so then this will be tested. Amounts paid from employers to employees are not gifts. So in order to exclude them from income, you have to put them under one of the other exclusion sections that we went over last month. Remember we went over section 132 and the non-taxable fringes and the de minimis fringes and the employer discounts. Right? In any transfer between an employer and an employee is taxable unless there is a code section directly excluding. Right? So remember that principle for the exam. So now the questions. Right, Mike Wallace, are we ready now? Okay, here we go. Taxpayer receives as a gift from TP's uncle on artwork with a fair market value of $15 and an adjusted basis to the uncle of $5,000. Uncle pays a gift tax of $1,500 with respect of the transfer to TP. Mike Wallace, question of the day. What is the gross income to TP? Well, you said 1,500, and who said zero?
It's the value, so it's zero, because it doesn't tax the value.
Are you sure, Mike Wallace?
I believe I'm sure.
On my
line, it's a zero.
Everybody at home say zero?
Zero.
Zero?
Zero.
Vote of hand, zero?
Zero.
Zero.
Issue? The answer is? Zero, right? Why? Because the gift itself is not taxable.
You use this as going to get the basis?
We're going to get the bill. Can you get ahead of the question? So now we're graded. Mike Wallace, we're three questions, two right, one wrong. Mike Wallace, now he's passing because he said 75. So Mike, going forward, you can only fail. You're now at passing. Okay. Personal property received as a bequest when taxpayer's mother dies. The fair market value of the property of the date of death is $500,000. But when it's finally distributed from the estate, $540,000. Mike Wallace, it could be a trick question. Say so. It's not a trick question. It's a question to see if you're understanding the general principle. All right, Mike Wallace.
Yes.
How much? State the amount of gross income.
Zero.
We're all at zero?
Yeah.
Yes. You don't think that the fact that it appreciated in value from the date of death to the date of distribution?
No.
All right, why is that? That is correct. There was no transfer. The property vests as of the date of death, right? There was no sale or exchange of the property. It vests as the date of death. That was the bequest. It was the inheritance. So the answer is zero. All right? And they do. Cecil says it's a trick question or a nuanced question, they always ask that. If you inherited the property, right, and there's no payment to you because of the use of your money, and there's no investment aspect, no matter how they ask you the question, the answer is going to be zero.
So I was kind of tricked by that question because of the appreciation from $540.
That's why not everybody passes, Mike Wallace. You know what that's called?
Not just
study. No, it's called studying. All right. Next. Also asked on the 4, 6, 8, and 12 exams is, all right, we got this property by gift. What's your basis, right? Because sometimes you're not going to gift it to the next generation or hold it forever. You know, we don't have dynasties. You know, sometimes you may want to sell what you inherited. So in order to figure out your taxable gain or loss, you have to know your basis. So how do you figure out this? What's the general rules, right? What do you guys, gift basis, what's the general rule?
Donor's
basis. Cecil's doing his homework. All right, on the other hand, if instead of the donor giving it to you during their life, they waited and they gave it to you at death.
Fair market value.
Absolutely. Those are the general principles. Gifts, same basis as it is in the hand of the donor. Bequest, inheritance, fair market value on the date of death. All right? And there are ways in the sections, right? One of the FAQs not on the exam is, can you estimate? How do we do it? What about these old records, right? And in the regs, they go through how you would reconstruct basis for the old gifts and all that. That's not going to be tested on the exam, but it is things you have to know. So, again, transfers in trust, also carryover basis. All right. So basis, what are we going to do? Increase in basis for gift tax paid. All right. This is going to be another one of the computation type questions on the exam. All right. There is going to be an increase in basis in a gift if the donor pays gift tax, right? And there's a formula to look at the ratio of the amount of the gift tax paid shall increase by an amount not to exceed the amount equal to the amount by the fair market value of the property at the time of the gift exceeds the basis of the property in the hands of the donor, right? So you're gonna have a formula. you know, one number, the fair market value on the top, and a basis on the bottom, all right? So the amount of the gift tax is the same ratio for all of the gifts in a year. So let's go to the question. Net appreciation of value equal the amount of fair market value gift over the donor's adjusted basis immediately before the gift. Okay? Calculation. All right, Wallace. Here we go. Be ready.
I'm ready. The next one.
Taxpayer gets a gift from his uncle of artwork, fair market value of $15,000. Okay? We know this uncle and nephew. The adjusted basis to the uncle was $5,000. The uncle pays the gift tax of $1,500. What is the taxpayer's adjusted basis, Mike Wallace?
It's going to be
$6,000. 85. 85? 6,500. All right, show of hands. Who goes for the Mike 6 and who goes for the 8,500? Right now we're asking the question, see if who's reading the question of the day answers.
I would go six, but some of the answers have taken the gift exclusion from the total value.
No. That's
different. We're not right now, we're looking at basis.
Yeah, we don't need to have basis.
Right, but the... Was the taxable gift?
65. We already know that we they had to pay the gift tax on, so that you're looking at fair market value. Let's go to it. Give you how we do the calculation. All right. You go to 1015. All right. You increase the basis for the gift tax paid over the formula that we talked about. Right. So what do we got? The net appreciation was 10,000, right? It's like the fair market value minus the adjusted basis is the appreciation, right? So then the gift tax paid, the ratio is net appreciation over the fair market value times the gift tax paid. So Mike Wallace was correct. The answer is 6,000, right? And again, in your head, they're not going to increase your basis for an untaxed appreciation, right? So that's really, you got to learn this formula,
I think what my friend is called donee's basis rather than donor's basis. Am I correct?
No, I was talking about the gift exclusion. It's true for here, it's obvious,
right.
But there have been other questions.
Yes, no, there's other questions, you're right. You got to read the question. Yes.
Based off the sale. That's really
okay.
Yeah, where you have to do the gift.
All right, guys. Remember, there are people at home, so if we have to, either give them a mic so the people at home can hear the dialogue. But yes, you're going to have to learn this formula because, as we just saw, it's on every exam. All right. So you look at the net appreciation over the fair market value, right? Then you multiply that by the gift tax rate. And the nice thing about it, it's always even numbers, right? So you knew that your answer on this one was either gonna be the 500 or the 1,000, because you're not gonna get the whole thing. So then they're gonna tell you how much of the increase in basis are you gonna get. So that was the ratio. So that's gonna be your clue, all right? Basis is 6,000, donor base 5,000, plus the gift tax paid on the net appreciation, right? That's the whole thing. They're going to give you increase in basis because...
Basically,
you take the net appreciation. He paid $1,500 in gift tax, all right? So, therefore, gift tax was paid on untaxed appreciation. So the code says you're going to get an increase in the basis. We're going to forget about the general rule of that you take the donor or the carryover basis, because some tax was paid. So they want to make it, they don't want to double bang. So you're going to get an increase in the basis for income tax purposes of the gift tax paid on the net appreciation. Right? So, not that tax fairness or equity goes into it, but that's what you want to think when you're saying, hey, what's going on here? They're increasing my basis for income tax purposes for when I sell, because the gift tax has already been paid on this appreciation. That's, I mean, if you want to go through the theory of why the number works. Okay. So, next, unified credit. Again, every one of us should know about unified credit, right? How much money can you give during life or at death without incurring an income, gift tax or an estate tax, right? All estate planning is based on knowing what the unified credit is. So it's tested, all right? Again, 2004, 2006, 2008, 2014. Only in 2008, eight was probably one of those transition years that, you know, where it was moving and the question would have been too complicated. But otherwise, they're always testing unified credit against the estate tax, all right? General rule, right? Every decedent has a credit against the estate tax. It's an amount that you can give to your loved ones during life or at death, free of paying estate or gift tax. Right? Now, this is a federal limit. Does New Jersey have the same limits? No, right? In New Jersey, it's still 2001. And in 2001, the unified credit was 675, right? How much is it today?
675.
Six, in New Jersey, it's still 675. Right? But the federal has gone way up, right? So applicable expense, $5 million plus an inflation adjustment, right? So what does that mean? The credit has been indexed for inflation. So without Congress doing anything, it goes up as inflation goes up. So when it was originally $5 million, because of the inflation adjustment for 2016, the first $5,450,000 is the unified credit, you know, is sheltered by the unified credit. That's the amount that you can give during life or at death tax-free. How much is it in New Jersey? Is there an inflation adjustment?
No.
No. Okay, so.
Do you think the exam's going to test on 15 though?
No, the exam's going to be a 16 exam, so it's going to be a 16 number. I'm not sure, but they'll tell you, right? In the exam, they tell you, assume what year. No, we're done. It was factory, but they're going to test on the 6. They always test on the year that you're taking the test. And if you don't get confused with numbers, that's why people are going to read the questions, right? We carefully read the question, right? Because one of the questions, right, I think one of the questions on depreciation calculation said you put the property in service in 8, but they asked you, what's the deduction in 12? Right, so you always have to read the question, right? Because, and the reason, well, we're going to go over that later. Why did they ask it that way?
Because they want to kill your time.
No, They wanted to test if they knew that when double declining balance is less than straight line, that's the transfer year for accelerated depreciation. That's why it said you put the property in service in 8, but they want to know what it was in 12 to test that little nuance.
They're just testing to see what you know. All right, so the question is, on the exam 6, how much money can a living donor making gifts and not have to pay a gift tax?
$14,000.
Let's go back. How much money? What did we say? Unified gift and what's the unified credit? What does the unified mean? That the estate tax and the gift tax are unified, right? That, because there was a time where there was a separate gift tax and there was an estate tax. So you had to calculate them differently.
But now there's a unified gift tax, a unified estate tax. So whether you give it during life or at death, the amount is the same. So now, Mike Wallace.
Yes.
How much can I gift?
$5 million.
It's the $5 million. So the annual exclusion is your $14,000, but your basic exclusion amount is for the giver is still $5,450,000. It's the $5 million with the inflation adjustment.
And when George Steinbrenner got away.
No, George Steingetter got away because there was that one year that there was no estate tax, right? The year that they didn't ask the question.
2010.
Right, 2010. Okay.
Prices went up in sales in 2009.
So. Next, taxable gifts, section 2503. Right, there's another, they also are gonna test the annual exclusion and the other types of gifts. So you got your unified credit, how much you can give away during life and death, then the annual exclusion is an amount that you give away that doesn't count against that. There's an amount that you can give away each year. That's called the annual exclusion amount. Annual means each year, all right? So there is an amount below the annual exclusion amount that you can give, make a present gift without eating into your credit. Right? That's how the insurance trusts work, and the 2503C trust, and lots of other trusts work. They're based on funding the trust with the annual exclusion amount. And we, you know, when we do a more detailed estate and gift tax seminar, we learn that. So Mike Wallace,
yes.
How much? Annual exclusion, 2016.
$14,000.
Very good.
Right. Was it a question?
That wasn't a question, so you're still at it. Three right, four, one wrong. But you're still passing. We're still at 75, we're still passing. Right, so first, again, this question is it's 10,000. So how do you calculate the annual exclusion? Just know that it's 14,000, but again, it's the 10,000 patient adjustment. And that is in the code. And you round it up to the next $1,000. That's how we're now there for the $14,000, all right? So what is eligible for the annual exclusion amount, right? Basically, you know, the gifts of the $14,000 that are called present interest gifts, right? A gift of money today is a present interest gift. That's an amount. So those are gonna go to the annual exclusion amount. There are certain gifts that you can give for a benefit of a minor. Those are the 2503C gifts or the trusts that are also treated as present interest gifts, even though the minor really can't use them until he's 21, right? That, you know, you can do the UGMA accounts. All right. So those are also treated as present interest gifts. What doesn't eat the annual exclusion or your gift tax? All right. What if you pay your kids' tuition directly to the school? You know, tuition's a lot of money, right? I mean, what did they say? I said some of the colleges are now $70,000 a year.
Yeah.
So you file, we all file gift tax returns. If you have 14,000, 70, that's like five gifts. You file in a gift tax return when you pay for your kids' college? Why not? It's because the code says if you pay it to an educational organization, that's not a gift. All right. What if your kid gets sick and you gotta pay the unreimbursed part of the medical insurance and it's $100,000? You gotta pay gift tax if you take care of a sick kid? Why? Because the code says transfers for purposes of medical care are not gifts. If these exclusions were not there, then there would be gift tax, right? So the takeaway, if the payment from the parent to the child or for the benefit of the child on the exam isn't in one of the definite exclusions from gift, then you're gonna say that gift tax applies, right? The general rule, a transfer for the benefit of another, whether it's, you know, above the 14,000,
is gonna be taxable, is gonna be a gift tax. Other than, unless you have an exclusion that we've talked about either in class or question of the day. So certain other things are not okay. So we didn't go over any of the questions. Okay, is this, where are we at break time? Jeff is 5 minutes early? All right, so let's get up. Jeff is the next, the person who's not gonna take the Mike Wallace role. Yeah, do this. Jeff's going to do the methods of accounting, right? The cash is not income now.
Still relying on the funds.
Hello, how's everyone? All right, so we're going to do methods of accounting and timing. Anyone who's gone through questions of the day or looked at the old exams, you'll know that this is on literally every single exam. Maggie's telling me to back up. It's on every single exam. The questions are generally the same types of questions. So let's just get into it. Before we get to the questions, we're just gonna kind of go over methods of accounting in general. I think we'll probably take a break in between, and then when we come back, we'll get to the actual questions, all right? All right, so first, what's a method of accounting? Methods of accounting, as most of you probably know, it's a way of treating certain items on the tax return. It's kind of a simple thing to say. It's very difficult in practice. There's a lot of nuance to it. Because what's the definition of an item? I mean, how do you define something for purposes of the method of accounting, like inventory? If you do something that's too broad, it leads to very inconsistent results, and it's very difficult to administer, okay? So, that being said, what's an item, all right? An item it's pretty simple. It's used to indicate any recurring incidence of income or expense on the return, and as you can see, I give you a few examples. Real estate taxes, annual fees for state truck licenses, baseball player contracts. As you can kind of see, these are kind of specific things, not broad things like just taxes or contracts, or as you can see, employees' vacation pay. Okay, so that being said, so we have an item. So when does it become material? Well, it's pretty simple. It's whenever it concerns the timing of income or deductions. Just kind of go through the slide there. So if it affects the taxpayer's lifetime income, it's not going to be material. But if it's something that affects the income or the deduction in a specific taxable year, then it's a material item, then it's relevant for the method of accounting. So just a quick example, there's a case called Schuster's Express that kind of explains the concept. Again, if it's something that affects the, something that's gonna affect the income or the deductions on this year's return, then that's how you determine whether it's a material item. All right, consistency. This is kind of intuitive. So if it's a method of accounting, it's kind of intuitive that it has to be consistent. The purpose of having a method is to treat something the same each time. Otherwise, it proves very difficult to, just in general, administer a tax system. So you have to treat items consistently over time, especially in the same year. Okay. So this next slide is called Methods of Accounting versus Error. It really should probably be called change in the method of accounting versus error. That's better. Change in the method of accounting versus error. You have to draw the distinction between if you're changing an item on the return versus changing a computational error that you've made on a return. The distinction that you want to draw is whether you're applying the method to the facts or of whether you're incorrectly applying the method to the facts and the return. For example, if you're just simply making a mistake, computational mistake. All right, so now we're gonna kind of get into, for purposes of the exam, this is what you're gonna kind of wanna know. All right, so this is the section, 446. It lists the general categories of permissible methods of accounting. For purposes of the exam, there's really three things that you're gonna wanna focus on. The first one's the cash method, all right? I'm sure a lot of you know what the cash method of accounting is. I'm just gonna go through it. Cash is not income. This, because it's New Jersey. That was a joke. In case you, it is New Jersey, so maybe people didn't realize. All right, so the cash method. All right, so just to summarize it, the taxpayer using the cash method of accounting recognizes income upon the receipt of cash, property, and services. Pretty intuitive. You receive cash, you're a cash method taxpayer, you receive cash, you included it in income upon receipt, right? On the exam, there have been questions that have simply asked to describe the difference between the cash method and the accrual method. In the event that you get a question like that, the answer really is not going to be any more complicated than what you see in front of you right now. The second bullet point there kind of distinguishes between cash and accrual. So the cash basis taxpayer is not going to recognize income upon the receipt of property in the form of promise to pay in the future. That's kind of the crux of the whole question. Cash basis taxpayer is going to recognize cash that they receive now. The third bullet point is kind of something that you'll see on the exam as well. Cash equivalents, they're going to ask you things to try to, not so much trick you, but try to make you think if, for example, the taxpayer is receiving something that's not cash, not specifically cash, you have to evaluate whether it's the equivalent of cash. Again, it's kind of like those questions that we had before, where they're asking you, where they're describing like the basis and the whole thing, but they're really just asking you, what's the gift tax, if there's any gift tax. It's the same type of thing. So you don't just evaluate whether the taxpayer received physical cash, whether it can also be a cash equivalent. All right, constructive receipt. For purposes of the exam, this is what the questions are gonna test you, all right? So what's constructive receipt? So constructive receipt occurs when cash or property is unqualifiedly available upon the taxpayer's demand without substantial limitations or restrictions. Now, what does that mean? You can't, if for example, I have the right to be paid for my services or be paid for my goods, and I say, maybe it's, I don't know, December 27th, and I made a lot of money this year, I don't want to report so much money on my return next year, and I'm gonna retire next year, and maybe I'd be better off getting that cash on January 3rd. And supplier comes to me and says, Jeff, I got your cash. And I say, you know what, keep it till January 3rd. Well, that's what the exam is gonna test you. So have I constructively received that cash?
Yes.
It's pretty straightforward, right? I mean, I can't just, this is gonna be on the exam for more than likely. I can't just refuse to accept the cash to try to manipulate my income in a certain way. All right, the accrual method. A little bit different than the cash method. And again, they might ask you just to describe the difference between the two. So just to go through what the accrual method is. So it's section 446, C2. And on the exam, if it asks you, this is all you would have to say is, permits a taxpayer to adopt an accrual method, a choice of words that may have been intended to avoid any implication that there's a single, right? That's to suggest that there's not really one specific accrual method. So accrual method, taxpayers recognize income when all the events have occurred, that's very important, those words that I just said, all the events have occurred, that fix their right to receive income, and the amount of the receipt is determinable with reasonable accuracy. That's called the all events test, and you can see it up there. That's one of those kind of benchmark tests in tax. I'm not sure if there's a question that specifically asks you for what the all events test is.
Sometimes, but you just, when we go through the hypos, they're gonna ask you, has everything been done for you, that you're entitled to the income? And really, they're gonna ask it more when we talk about deductions later. You know, are you entitled to the deduction?
So,
but that's part inherent in the cash method versus the accrual method. Cash, really, the simplest way is deposit it into the bank. That's your cash method of accounting. Your accrual basis is you've sent out the invoice. You don't have the cash yet, but the all events have occurred, then you're entitled to the money. All right, so that's the accrual method. So, but it'll come through the questions.
Right, what Frank is saying is they might not necessarily say what's the definition of the all events test. But this is the test. This is on the exam, and that last bullet point on this slide is on the exam. Can't put it any simpler than that. Okay. All right. So accrual method, like cash method, we can also have constructive receipt. Again, constructive receipt is how they test this topic on the exam, because it would be so simple if people just received stuff and reported it when they received it. So also in certain cases, accrual basis taxpayers can defer recognizing an income upon the receipt of advance payments for property or services.
Thank you, Maggie.
All right. So beyond the cash and accrual method, there's also the other permissible method. It's 446C3. Which allows you to generally use any other method provided by this chapter. It's kind of like a catch-all. I've given you a few examples at the bottom there. I'm not going to define them, but just be aware that it's kind of like a catch-all, which lets you use any acceptable method of accounting. There's going to be some slides on what's an acceptable method. All right. So, is there a way to manipulate deductions and income if I have related parties? Generally, no. There's a section of 267A 2 that prevents you from exploiting the method of accounting rules when you're dealing with related persons. And then I'll give you an example there. So, for example, an accrual method corporation could deduct, at the time the expense is incurred, interest owed to its sole shareholder. An individual on the cash method without making payment, and the shareholder will not have to include the interest in gross income until received. All right, so that would be kind of manipulating the system. So what does Congress say? Well, generally, no, you can't do that. Persons who are related should be required to use the same accounting method with respect to transactions between themselves in order to prevent the allowance of a deduction without the corresponding inclusion of income. Basically, it prevents related parties from manipulating their methods of accounting to benefit just themselves. So what's the section 267A2 deferral? I'm just gonna read it to you. So the deduction is allowed as to an item only when the item is includable in gross income of the recipient, but only if the amount is not includable in the gross income of the recipient until paid, because that person uses the cash method of accounting, and the payor and the recipient are related persons described in 267D. At the close of the taxable year for which the item would otherwise be deductible. That's just stated in this section. Next, this is just some examples of related persons. Individuals and family members, corporations and those who own them, two corporations that are members of the same group, grantors and fiduciaries of the trust, fiduciaries and beneficiaries of trust. These are all the 267 rules that kind of apply universally to lots of other sections of the code. Again, more related persons. All right, so what's the effect on deductions based on the method of accounting? All right, so cash method taxpayers. So when are cash method taxpayers permitted to take deductions?
When they pay.
No simpler than that. Give you the reg there. So what's constructive payment? Can we have constructive payment when we have a cash method taxpayer?
Yes.
Who said yes? You want to just elaborate now? Okay. So generally, yes. Generally, I'm going to say the answer is yes. I don't remember there being an actual question.
When a check becomes a cash.
You mean if I write a check and give somebody, is that cash?
Is there money in the bank to cover it?
No.
Well, then that's going to be the
well,
answer to that.
Well, then that's...
Because they're going to ask you in the question, right? You know, they tell you when, and we're going to get to the
question. When we get to the question, yeah.
They're going to tell you, and you read the question, that there's no money to cover the check, right? So then they're going to ask you, now, you get a deduction for a promise to bank. Because what's a check that where there's no money in the bank to cover? It's a promise to bank. You get a deduction for a promise to bank? No. That's where you get to those questions.
So, are you asking if you write a check and you know you don't have money in the bank, or somebody writes you a check and you're not sure they have money in the bank?
Well, they write you a check, but you don't cash a check, you cash it at a later date. That's your constructive receipt.
TBD, after the break, you'll get your answer.
To be determined.
Yeah. We'll be discussing that after the break. No questions. Did someone have a question? Okay. An example of the tax court discussing constructive payment. Tax court has held that a cash basis taxpayer could not deduct salary constructively received by its officers, stating that constructive payment does not necessarily flow from constructive receipt. I don't think that's a universal thing. It's a generally accepted principle. I'm gonna skip through a couple of these here. All right, what if I choose a method of accounting contrary to the code? Can I do that?
With permission.
With permission?
Yep.
What if it's explicitly mandated that it's not permitted by the code? Let's say it's like permitted by gap accounting.
If it's reflecting income expense properly, then it can go.
But the code tells me I can't use it.
Then don't you have to request
the code?
Approved.
The code.
If the code says no, you can't do it on a tax return. Don't think more complicated than that.
However,
the code said no.
But the code could say no. But if the taxpayer could prove that
the taxpayer is never going to overrule the code. The code is the code.
I think that this gap method is better.
Yes.
All right. I like it better. It's better. It's good. Let's go with it. The code says you can't do it. You gotta go by the code. It's the tax return, right? We're saying that we're following the code, the regulations. We don't have an ability ever to say the code is wrong.
I know that it's the code we trust, like a back to bill.
All right. Remember the all events test. With respect to deductibility and liability. So no liability can be taken into account for federal tax purposes. including through capitalization as an increase to the basis or purchase or constructed property, until it has been paid or incurred. That's the general concept that we talked about before. What's my time?
I just want to go on. Like, the perfect example today is marijuana, right? How many of these businesses that are legal in Colorado have expenses, and they say, look, we would like to take, you know, go on the cash method for these expenses that would be in any other business, ordinary and necessary business expenses. Can you file a return, sign a return that says the code, section 280E, that says if you're selling illegal drugs, your method of counting is no deductions. Can you sign that return?
No.
No, because the code says no. Section 280E, it precludes you from taking deductions on the cash method or the accrual method for the expenses of production of income for any drug that is, you know, on the list.
Even in Washington State,
What are the rules? Constitution, right? On top, Constitution of the United States. Right? Then, below the Constitution, laws by Congress. All right? Supremacy clause of the Constitution. If there is a federal law, and then there is a state law that is contrary to the federal law, what controls?
The federal law.
And how do we know that? We fought a war, the Civil War. Right? There were these states who said, we don't like the way the federal law works. They tried to secede. They tried to leave. They tried to say, we know better. But what controls? The United States Constitution, supremacy, federal law, state law. What they're doing in Colorado is illegal under federal law. Can they go to a bank and deposit the proceeds of this drug dealing?
No.
Why? It would be money laundering. Any bank that took it would be in violation of the federal money laundering statutes. So that's why you hear in all these states that they have to deal in cash, because no legitimate financial institution will take the risk of violating federal law and being forfeited.
And they can't get Fedwire accounts.
And they can't get Fedwire accounts, and they can't do that. You
know, and the IRS actually penalizes them for paying their taxes in cash.
No, they stopped.
They stopped that.
They said they can pay in cash.
Right?
What?
They're filing, and they should be filing returns.
On the gross. Right.
Which probably is the sales tax, right?
Oh, it's 25%, I thought, in the Colorado. We make money off illegal drugs, right? We've always made money from illegal activity. You know, the government is your partner in good times. So if you're making money from drugs, from prostitution, look, I had a contract killer. He went to jail. Not for the contract killing, but because he didn't pay tax on the money, right? They're your partner in good times. What?
I'm sorry? Well, yeah, they were. They could. Well, all right. We're getting a little far.
Trust the code.
We'll talk about it at the break. All right. There was an article I just recently reread an article, but we'll talk about it at the break.
Can you send the article out?
Yeah, please. Sure. it's like a year and a half old, but I'll try to dig it up. All right. So, what's economic performance? What all the activities have been performed that are required to satisfy the liability? Again, that's going to be the test. We're going to take a break in just a minute. Timing of the payor's deduction, cash method. Payor uses cash receipts and disbursements if their cash method. When did they deduct it? In the year it was paid. Simple. Timing on the accrual basis, all right, a little bit different. In the year in which all events have occurred, against the all events test, the amount of the liability can be determined with reasonable accuracy, and economic performance has occurred with respect to the liability. This is what they're going to test you on. Let me scroll ahead a little bit. Contested liabilities. I think this is tested. This might have came up in one of the exams. So contested liability, what's a contested liability? Well, if I don't feel that I owe you money, or if I feel I owe you less, if I'm an accrual, I'm not allowed to claim an otherwise allowable deduction for payments to provide for the satisfaction of contested liabilities unless the economic performance requirements are satisfied. So what does that mean? What's that?
Contested liability. You sue me, all right? You sue me for $1 million. I say, I don't owe you the money. On the other hand, when I'm doing my tax return, you're suing me for $1 million. Can I accrue that? Can I just say, hey, I got $1 million deduction because you sued me for $1 million? No, because it's a contested liability, right? So even though I'd love to, I would say that all the economic performance occurred, I'm not paying the million. I'm contesting the million. So that's a contested liability.
So there is a way you can deduct it. As Frank left, yes, that would, I mean, you actually have to pay it. You can test it, but you have to pay it. So it really kind of eliminates the problem anyway, because you paid it. We're kind of past the break, so I'm gonna kind of go through a couple of these. All right, I just wanna do this. This is a hypo, all right? This was, I thought this was gonna make it onto the 2014 exam. This is a 2014 case. I'm gonna read the hypo, and then I'm just gonna pose a question to the audience. So P, petitioner, owns and operates supermarkets and gas stations. So you've all been to a supermarket, gas station. So petitioner offers customer loyalty program by which customers make qualifying purchases at the supermarkets. They can earn fuel perks that were redeemable against the purchase of gasoline. So they get some sort of credit to buy gas at the same place. P was an accrual basis taxpayer and claimed a deduction for the unredeemed fuel perks. So in the event that a customer received these fuel perks that they could eventually use, the petitioner deducted them, assuming that they would eventually use them. So the question is,
can you deduct it?
No.
So under the all events test, can petitioner properly accrue and deduct expenses for the unredeemed fuel perks? And if this is what the court asked, if no, can petitioner offset the certain sales by the estimated future redemption of the future fuel perks? So is there a consensus?
No.
Everyone says no? That's right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The all events test, this is what the court said. The all events test requires that any condition precedent to fixing the liability must occur before the first prong of the test is met. Therefore, the liability occurs when the customer redeems the fuel perk, not when they earn the right to redeem them.
After 5 years, he has to set it up to unclaimed assets.
Yeah, it would probably at some point escheat to the state. That's a whole other problem that we're not going to go through. The second part of the answer is, so can he offset the revenue? No. The exception to the all events test, I give you the right there. Taxpayer can deduct only the portion of the coupons that will eventually be redeemed. The reg requires the coupons to be redeemable in merchandise, cash, or other property. So allowing a present deduction with respect to redemptions conditioned on an additional purchase can result in a mismatching of expenses and revenues, contrary to the regulation's primary purpose. This is the key language. The fuel perks are conditions on a subsequent purchase and are therefore not redeemable for merchandise, cash, or other property. So at this point, we're gonna take a short break. That was a question from a case in 2014. So we're gonna take 10 minutes and then we'll start up with a couple of method of accounting questions, right?
X and Y are cash method taxpayers, right? They're on a calendar year. On December 15th, Year one, Y sold and delivered to X, goods to be sold in X's business. The terms of the sale provided that the payment was due within 30 days of the delivery of the goods. The following are the alternate situations. What?
Four subparts.
It's going to be four subparts. On December 31, X offers to pay in cash for the goods, but Y refused and asked that X pay in January. If X made the payment in cash to Y on January 5th, year two, should Y report the gross income from the sale of the goods? Jeff?
Okay, so I think I know the answer. So if X made the payment in cash on Y in year two, when should Y report the gross income?
Never,
well,
New Jersey.
Never, because it's in New Jersey. That's option three. But I'm going to say that it's, can you go back one second? I'm going to say he should have reported it in year one. And why is that? He could have received the cash, we're talking about physical cash here, on December 31st, but he refused. He constructively received it on December 31st in year one. He should report it. It's includable in gross income in year one. Just do the four subparts and then we do the rules.
So refusal of income is not constructive receipt?
No. No, it is.
We're going to take you through the questions then. And then get, okay. So question two. Y receives the payment in a check by X dated December 24th. If Y waited to cash the check until January 3rd, and the check was honored by X's bank, when does Y report?
Year one.
Generally year one, a check is considered cash. The question could be worded to trick you a little bit. For example, if December 27th was like a Friday or something, that's not in the question. A check is considered cash. A check in the hands of the person who received it is considered received. It would be includable in gross income in year one.
Now, on December 27th, year one, B's bookkeeper, a full-time employee of Y, received his payment, a check from X that was dated December 24th, year one, and which was payable to Y. The bookkeeper left on a holiday trip without depositing the check, and the bookkeeper doesn't come until January 4th. Year two, on which date the bookkeeper delivered the check to Y, who cashed the check at X's bank. When should Y report the income?
Year two. That's what he's
instructed. The bookkeeper, a full-time employee of Y, received the check on December 24th.
Year one.
Then last, Jeff, on Y received from X a promissory note in the amount of X's indebtedness to Y. The note was transferred to Y because X had no cash and he was in severe financial difficulty. The note was non-negotiable, bore no interest, was due in 180 days during December, January, February, and March. Y attempted to negotiate the note, but nobody would take it. On May 1, year 2, X made full payment on the note. When should Y report the gross income?
Year 2.
When the promise was fulfilled. So just again, is the promissory note a cash equivalent?
No.
Is the promissory note in year one, is there any reason to believe that it has value? No, it's in severe financial distress.
It's what common sense, constructive receipt, right? When you have the unqualified right, you got to pick it up, right? When you get a check, but you decide not to deposit in the bank, you got to pick it up, right?
Just just, you know, note the language in these substantial limitations and restrictions.
The note is a promise to pay, right? They gave you the fact that it was non-negotiable. So all you're getting is a promise to pay. He tried to negotiate it. Nobody would take the note. Tells you it's not a cash equivalent. You can't convert it. Right. What's the general rule on cash equivalent? Can you convert it to cash, right? So if they give you, if you get, instead of somebody paying you in cash, they give you stock on that's freely tradable on the New York Stock Exchange. You can convert that to cash right away.
Mm-hmm. That's a cash equivalent.
It's a cash equivalent. What if I gave you gold? Gold. Gold's good. Cash equivalent. Okay. If I gave you property that was easily convertible to cash, right, then you got income, right? Income, accession to your wealth. If you did your own balance sheet the day after you received the cash equivalent, did you have an accession to your wealth?
Yes.
Then that's going to be a cash equivalent, right? If you're worth more because you've got it,
cash,
that's a cash equivalent.
Cash in the bank.
Cash is cash. Right? It doesn't even have to be in a bank. Cash in my mattress is still income.
Cash on hand and cash in the bank.
I think cash in my mattress. Not in New Jersey, but yes. Yes. How much was it worth today? Okay. If you receive, let's go to the, and these are like the Bernie Madoff cases, right? If you got cash today, or you got stock in a company today. We got stock in Fiat, and it's selling at 25 today. Do I have income? Do I have cash equivalent today?
Yes. Yeah. No, 4 days, 5 days.
Well, it doesn't matter if I sell. Oh, so I could defer my income. Instead of giving me cash, give me a Renoir. All right, I've got it hanging on my wall. So now I don't have income because I didn't sell the painting?
Yes, because when you sell it, then the entire sales price becomes.
No. Then barter would never be taxable. Say, I provide legal, so you prepare a tax return for somebody. And instead of.
It's instead of a service
yes.
return that not just got.
Well, why did you get it? They get.
Because
this was
nice
for goods.
Exactly.
If it's just because they're nice to you, then it could be a gift.
Could be
then
a
it would not be. Then the questions on the gift were it's not includable at all, right? Why did you get it? Did you get it because somebody wanted to be nice to you? The kindness of strangers, the tax generosity? Then it's a gift. Gifts, inheritance, bequest, divides, section 102, not taxable.
So you got the painting in payment.
Then that's taxable. That's barter. Bartering income is taxable. Yes.
If someone gives you cash on January 1st and you don't put it in the bank, you left it on your table, and you tell the IRS that you just use it as sticks to make marshmallows or something, it's still cash in your hand.
It doesn't matter what you use the cash for.
That's
the beauty of cash. All right? Nobody, you know, does it. It's yours. You can throw it up. You can bet it on black. It's still cash. It was still income. Doesn't matter what you do with it. If you made a lot of money with it, it was still income. If you lost it at the tables, it was still income. It's cash.
It was.
It was cash. All right. Next question. TP Corporation is engaged in a trade or business to enhance its profitability. It enters into a management consulting contract. The contract provides that X will provide services to PP over 3 years. Right? Contract requires the performance of 40% of services in year one, 30% of services in year two, and the remaining in year three. The contract requires TP to pay $100,000, 50% in year one, 30% in year two, 20% in year three. Discuss when TP will be permitted to deduct the amounts paid to X if TP uses the accrual method of accounting. All right, Jeff, what are we doing here? Year one, year two, year three.
Well, I forget the exact amounts because I did it a while ago, but it's, if I recall correctly, it's the all-event status. with all the events that occurred.
That's right.
I'm trying to. The question is asking when it's deductible.
That's correct.
When all the events have occurred that would affix the liability.
Economic performance.
Economic. I'm trying to.
You wanted to charge 10%
year two?
Yes, and we have it with an asset industry.
Who knows the man? Who's done the question at home? That's right. $50,000 a year.
$30,000 a year, $20,000.
$20,000 a year.
They're there, right?
If you read the publication, there are specific rules that say that the first payment is the first year, but the balance, regardless how many years after, the entire balance has to be paid up before the end of year two, or by the end of year two.
That's when you capitalize. We'll give you one of those. Okay. Taxpayer elects the cash method. Must TP obtain the consent of the IRS to change from to the accrual?
Yes.
Everybody knows the
rule. Yes.
Taxpayer has to get the IRS's consent. So when you choose a method, the IRS doesn't tell you what your initial method is. But when you change, you got to get consent. Okay. Jeff, question four. Taxpayers elected the calendar year and the accrual method. Over a three-year period, TP is entitled to receive amounts from X. Now, X pays TP any amount before the due date. How does X properly report the payment?
Well, I forget if it tells you if you're cash or accrual.
It says you're accrual.
Oh, you're accrual.
Right. You still got the cash.
Right. Deferred revenue.
Is it deferred revenue? The TP is entitled to receive amounts. What if he gets a prepayment? It doesn't say it's a deposit, it's a prepayment, guys. Give you a hint. Does he pick it up?
No. Deferred revenue.
Okay. Advance payments have to be included. This is a trick, and it is, because they're going to ask you about this one with rent. So this is advance payment rule. In the taxable year of receipt, all right, or the taxable year properly accruable under the method of accounting, if such method results in advance payments, don't let, you know, basically the 1 year rule, you're going to pick that one up.
I had trouble with this one.
Yeah, I know. Just, I'm going to tell you, for purpose of the exam, you got the money up front. You're not segregating it as a deposit, right? When the key to this question when they ask it on the exam is, if you're segregating it again, you're holding it separately as a deposit, that's different from a prepayment. Right. The prepayment is the advance payment that the reg says you pick up an income. And there's gonna be another question on this one. It's not there. But one of the questions in the homework was the rent question, the prepaid rent. And what do we got? What's the rule on the prepaid rent?
Has to be portion.
Okay. Well, wait. You get the deduction. Now, on the inclusion side, you're the landlord. You get the rent early. Do you include it or not?
Yes.
All right. You're the tenant. You pay the rent early. Can you deduct it early?
No.
On rent, a special rule. There's a special rule on rent that you have to accrue it over the term. That is one of those exceptions. You're thinking about the 1 year rule on deductions, yeah. And Jeff started like this special methods of accounting for rent, and that's one of the questions on the question of the day. Rent is different.
Rent is included in the year received.
Rent is included in the year received, but deducted ratably over the earning of the period, right? Because
matching counts.
No, it's the opposite of matching. It's bad. Because not bad. I don't want to say the code is bad. How can I say that? It's you include the income early, right? Because you got the cash, but you don't get the deduction because you haven't used the space yet. So it is accelerating the income and deferring the expense.
It means the government is making money on our money. That's
generally. Accelerate the taxes too.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. They're making money on our money. Yes, sir.
Was renewed, for example, for another 5 years.
Okay.
So 5 plus 5, that's what we have determined.
But you still, that's the difference with rent. You gotta deduct the rent as you use the period, as it burns off. You can't accelerate your rent deductions.
As it's earned.
Yeah, as it's earned.
All right, okay, now. Come on, Emma's nervous now.
All right, because one of the hardest of the questions, but also asked every year, is section 453. Installment sale questions, right? They're gonna ask you about, instead of getting your cash up front, money over time, okay? Now, what have we learned? What is our general rule? What are we trying to do? You're gonna tax, right? Principal and gain. Principal and gain. So you have to learn what are we paying tax on? Are we paying tax on principal?
No.
No, we're paying tax on gain. So now, what if a payment is part principal, part gain?
Plus interest.
Plus, then interest is separate, right? First, you pay, you have to make an allocation. Your allocation allocates, you never tax the receipt of your principal. You always tax your gain. But for the installment sale method,
you must know your gross profit before you.
Well, you gotta figure it out and make the allocation. And that's what this is all about, right? 453. All right, so get out, Emma. She's one of the students. I'm gonna do this to all of you eventually. So Emma's got the 453 questions on the exam. Okay, let's get it. Is on 2006, 2008, 2010, 2012. They always ask about installment sale. All right. So Emma, tell me, give me the bait. You can move the clicker.
Hello.
Hi, Emma.
Hello. I'm Emma, and I am a student from Fordham University. My major is taxation and accounting. I am interning in Agostino and Associates this summer. So maybe some of you have read the question of the day posted by me. I'm very happy it will help you. And today my topic is instrument method. First, I will introduce section 433 and section 453B. And then I will use a question from 2006 S1 as an example to apply the code. It's a long question and it's a tough one for me. Now,
we'll help you.
Thank you. Now, let's talk about section 453. I will introduce three concepts in this code. They are instrument sale, instrument method, and the contract price. So, about instrument sale, what is instrument sale? Instrument sale means when you sell something, when you receive the payment from buyer, if at least one payment is to be received after the close of the taxable year, it will be an instrument sale. So for example, if you sell your house in year one and you receive the payment from buyer in year two, year three, that will be an instrument sale. And what is instrument method? Instrument method means a method under which the income recognized for any taxable year from a disposition is that proportion of the payments received in that year which the gross profit spares to the total contract price. So you have to calculate two numbers. You have to know what is the gross profit, and you have to know what is the contract price. So what is the contract price? Now you have to know three numbers before you know the contract price. First, you have to know the selling price. Then you have to know the mortgage, debts, and other liabilities assumed or taken by the buyer. Sorry, the microphone is taller than me. And you have to know the amount by which the mortgage, debts, and other liabilities assumed or taken by the buyer exceed your adjusted basis. Then you use the first number minus the second number, then plus the third number. Now you got your contract price. For purpose of exam, I think that is all you have to know for the code section 353 or 453. Now, let's talk about code section 453B. I will introduce the general rule first, and then I will tell you how to calculate the basis of obligation. Okay, thank you. And the general rule tells us, if you want to know the gain or loss, I'm sorry. Maybe we should have a break.
Here, here.
Miracle. Now,
I said it to do that to make her nervous.
Thank you for your patience. If you want to know the gain or loss, you should compare two numbers. There are two cases. Case one, in case of satisfaction at other than face value or a sale or exchange, you should compare the basis of the obligation and the amount realized. And case two, if this exchange is not, or if this distribution, transmission, or disposition otherwise than by sale or exchange, you should compare the basis of the obligation with the fair market value of the obligation at the time of distribution. And the case two is the case what we will learn in the question. In the question, the taxpayer transferred the property to taxpayer's grandchildren. That is a gift. So you should use the case two. You should compare basis with the fair market value, not the amount realized. That is what I want to focus on. Then you have to know what is the basis of the obligation. When you compute the basis of the obligation, you should know the face value of the obligation and you should know the income returnable.
Question. When you ask to calculate the basis of obligation, this is done after installment payments have been made in the years. Is that correct?
Yes.
Because the basis will eventually adjust when payments are made.
Yes.
The key. Okay. I hope you understand.
That's when they get the questions, they'll get there.
No, the basis doesn't change.
So maybe we can.
On the note, when you look at fair market value of the note, is X any payments that make? Say you have a $500,000 note, but there's $250,000 of payments that are, have been already made. The value of your note is not $500,000 anymore. It's now $250,000 because why? Half of the payments under the installment note have been paid.
And then right?
The face value of the note has now changed because you've made payments.
Right? So the basis would
be. Otherwise, you keep paying tax on the same amount.
Yeah,
right? Keep going. You'll see it when we go through the questions.
Yes. Now we have the question. It's a long question.
All right, I'll read the question to them.
Thank you.
And then you'll answer the question. Okay. So right now, Emma's, let's get her passed. The TP purchased unimproved real property, right? Lot acre in 1998 for cash for $250,000. In 2000, TP encumbers the property with a mortgage to secure a loan of $100,000. So he borrows $100 against the property. And he uses the money to buy securities, right? So he has a piece of property, he borrows $100,000 against the piece of property, and he buys some stock. So how much is his basis in the property changed because he borrowed against it?
Zero.
Okay. So then on December 31st, 2004, when TP's basis in the property is still the $250,000, TP sells the property. He gets $200,000 cash at closing. He assumes a mortgage note of $100,000, buyer assumes, and buyer executes a promissory note payable to TP in the amount of $300,000. All right, so $200,000 cash, assumes a mortgage of $100,000 that was still on the property, right? The $100,000 that they borrowed stays on the property. And then he gives him a note for another three. So the question, now the note gives principal payments of $100,000 on the anniversary of the date of the sale in each of the 3 years following the year of sale. The promissory note requires a payment of 60% interest, that's a nice interest rate. Then the note has a fair market value of $290,000. So it's a $300,000 note, but it's only worth, you can only sell the note in the market for $290,000. TP receives the $100,000 down, the $100,000 payment in December of 2005. And then on January 2006, he transfers the note that then has a fair market value of $185,000, right? Because he's got the $100,000 payment, and then it even declined in value a little bit, right? So now it's down to a fair market value of $185,000, right? To TP's grandchild as a gift. Tell me, 2005, 2006, what are the tax consequences to TP under 453 and 453B. All right, Emma, tell us, what do we got going on here? You can have your timeline.
As you can see, I am not so good at English, so I have to simplify the question. This is the timeline. I'm sorry, I should make it bigger. For those who sit so far away, I will read this for you, don't worry. Can you see the right point? The taxpayer has basis $250,000 and he assumed the mortgage $100,000. And taxpayer received payment from buyer in three ways: cash, mortgage, and note. Only in notes, we should use the instrument method. So in 2004, taxpayer recognized the cash, $200,000, mortgage assumed by buyer, $100,000, but nothing from notes, right? That's all for the year one, 2004. Then we come to year two, 2005. Sorry, I have to do it in a very slow because it's very hard for me. And in year two, in 2005 December, buyer paid taxpayer on notes 100,000. And according to the plan, buyer will pay 100,000 in any in the anniversary dates on year 2006 and 2007. But taxpayer transferred the note to taxpayer's grandchildren on the first day of 2006. So we can divide this question into two parts from this point. Before 2006, we can include this as a part one. And in this part, we should use section 453 to calculate the instrument method, to use the instrument method to calculate the income recognized in year 2005. And after that, that is part two, we should use section 453B to calculate gains or loss of gain or loss in the transfer of the note. So in this way, we really simplified the question, right? Now let's do part one. According to section 453, paragraph C, you should use instrument methods to calculate the income recognized for any taxable year. In this year, 2005, you should know the amounts received in this year, and you should know one very important ratio, that is the gross profit and the contract price. GP stands for gross profit and CP stands for contract price. There are three formulas I want you to know. I'm sorry, my time's up.
Still answer your question.
Gross profit equals selling price minus basis, and contract price equals selling price minus debts, which does not exceed the seller's basis. If you are wake up when I am telling the section 453, that's what I told just before. And you can see in the first two formula, you have to know the selling price. So what is selling price? That is not in the code. That is calculated by this formula. Selling price equals cash plus mortgage plus note. But you have to focus that you should use the fair market value of the note.
600,000?
Yes. 290,000. In the year 2004 December, that is the fair market value of the notes, 290,000. So now you got the selling price, 590,000. Then you bring this number into the first two formulas. You got your gross profit, 340,000, and you got your contract price, 490,000. Then you bring these two numbers into the very first formula. You got your notes recognized in year 2005. That is about 69,387. So now we almost finish our first part. in our part two, we should use the section 453B. In the general rule, when you try to calculate the gain or loss, you should know two numbers, right? You should know the basis of obligation and you should know the fair market value of obligation, because in this case, taxpayer transferred the property as a gift. So how to calculate the basis of obligation? You should know face value of obligation and you should know the income returnable. Then you got your basis of obligation. Then you bring it back into the first formula. Then you get your gain. That is 126,784.
Can you go back to the first line? In the parentheses, you have 190, which is the remaining note, right? Times
yes.
The contract price.
Yes.
Plus the 10,000. How? Where did we get that 10,000 from?
300 less than
10,000.
300 less than 10,000.
Yes, okay. That's
so
the exchange.
Total amount less the fake.
Fair market value.
Okay.
Yes.
So we don't lose that 10,000 all the way from the beginning.
That's why they say you use the base value.
Right. And maybe that's why they didn't ask us to gain realize in year one.
No.
The sale.
Because no, they didn't ask you.
300, that yes. becomes part of the sale price. The 10,000 part of the sale price in year one. When it was sold.
No, because how do you determine sales price? Sales price, you look at what you received. And what did you receive? You received 200,000 cash. You received no forgiveness of 100 because they assumed the mortgage. And then you got a note. But how do we value notes? Not at the face. We look at the fair market value. And in the question, they told you that the fair market value of the note was 290, not 300. They were testing to see whether you knew that you report the gain or loss on the fair market value of the note, not the face of that amount of the note. Say, what if I paid you with a note from Puerto Rico, right? Right now, bonds from Puerto Rico are selling at a big discount, right? So if I gave you a note issued by Puerto Rico at a fair value, on a face value of $1 million, and I transfer that note to you because I owed you $1 million, are you going to be happy with me?
No.
Why?
It's not worth it.
Why? Right. Okay. So that's why you look at fair market value on the date of transfer. It doesn't matter what the face value of the note could be $1 billion. Right?
But it's not paid.
All right. That's the base. I don't know if you guys read the taxpayer question today. Lots of shelters were based on buying distressed currency. And trying to say, hey, I paid in these notes from this other country that had a face amount of X, but because they were devalued, they were worth one-tenth X, right? Do I get a deduction for one-tenth X, the fair value of what I paid? Or do I get the face amount of the note, right? That's the there were some shelters where people went out and they bought distressed currency. And then they said, I'm gonna buy it at $10, but the face is $1,000, and I'm gonna take a deduction for $1,000. Does that work for you? That's called a shelter. That's bad. So that's why you look at fair value. Oh, okay. So I think do we have slide.
So that's a very tough question for me. Now I need a break. Do you?
Thank you, Emma.
Thank you.
Again, right. There's a recovery of basis in that for the share, right?
We're going to take a very short break. Thank you, Emma. You're all eventually, you're going to get a call from me the next time. That's your question of the day night. So let's take a very, a 5-minute break, and then we're going to go to the next question. Thanks.
All right, we're going to start up. All right, so first of all, thank you to Emma. She did a great job. So next we're gonna have Reva, who is also an intern at Agostino & Associates, and she's also a student at Fordham. I'm gonna let her introduce herself a little bit. Just so you know, she's gonna talk about depreciation, section 168, and I think 179 as well, right? All right, so just let's welcome Reva, and thank you very much.
Hello everyone, my name is Reva. So I'm a current master student at Fordham University, and I'm now majoring in accounting and taxation. I'm also interning with Agostino & Associates. So today I'm going to talk about the depreciation under section 168 and 179. And I will also take questions from the 2010 US Tax Court exam as an example to apply these rules. So depreciation has a special name in tax. Technically, it's called recovery deduction because you are recovering your basis. So your basis is your unrecovered cost. One of the ways to recover your cost is by depreciating your assets. In mid-1980s, ACRES, which is Accelerated Cost Recovery System, was invented for US tax law for depreciation. So tax law allows for accelerated method and accelerated life. You get double benefits. In late 1980s, they changed it to a MACRS, which is Modified Accelerated Cost Recovery System. So what is MACRS property? Generally, MACRS property is tangible property placed in service after 1986, in tax years ending after 1986. However, there is an exception. You can elect to apply MACRS to property placed in service during the last 5 months of 1986. So MACRS cannot be used in intangible property, and buying is not enough. The key phrase here is placed in service. And there are some exceptions to the general MACRS property, including property depreciated in other specified methods in the first year, certain public utility property, films and videotape, sound recordings, and certain property placed in service in turning transactions. So MACRS cannot be applied to these properties. The general MACRS calculates depreciation deduction using the applicable depreciation method, applicable recovery period, and applicable convention. So there is no salvage value in tax law. You will depreciate all the way down to the zero in tax. So, applicable depreciation method. Generally, MACRS use double declining balance, which is twice straight line rate. Let me ask you a question. If you use twice straight line rate of declining balance, will you ever fully depreciate the asset? The answer is yes or no? Okay.
Could you repeat it?
So if you use twice straight line rate on declining balance, will you ever fully depreciate the asset?
No. Sounds like everything in the last year, don't they?
No.
What's left in the last year?
The answer is no. So what happens when you use double declining balance? In financial accounting, you switch to straight line about halfway through. Why? Because if you don't switch, you will never depreciate the asset. You will always be taking some percentage times smaller and smaller numbers and never get to zero. So it's selling tax. You switch at the applicable moment to accelerate the deduction as much as possible. So applicable recovery period. If you buy an asset, you will have a recovery life assigned to that asset based on its class.
And that life is guaranteed for the rest of that life of the asset when you own it, no matter what future tax law changes are. Here is a table about classification of property. So when you buy an asset, you have to look it up and figure out what category it falls into. Most equipment falls into 7 or 10 years lives. For computer, because of technology changes, it will probably have 3 or 5 years life. For buildings, they have a whole nother story. If they are residential rental buildings, they have 75.5 years lives. If they are non-residential buildings, they have 39 years lives. I just want to focus on this like residential rental property because it may be tested in the exam. So in order to be qualified for the residential rental property, you have to meet the 80% test, which means for tax year in question, 80% or more of the gross rental income from the building has to be the rental income from the dwelling units. And here is the definition of dwelling units. It's a house or apartment used to provide living accommodations in a building or structure, but does not include a unit in hotel, motel, or other establishment. More than 1/2 of the units in which are used in a transition basis. Now we talk about applicable convention. Generally, we take half-year convention. Half-year convention is when you buy a property, you assume you bought it on July 1st. You assume you bought it midway through the year. It doesn't matter when you actually bought it, either in January or December. Anywhere between, you pretend you bought it midway through the year. So it's same is true in the year of disposition. When you dispose the asset, you will get half year depreciation in the year of disposition. So when do I use mid-month convention? It applies to non-residential real property, residential rental property, and the railroad grading and tunnel bonds. For example, if you rent a residential property out in September, you will be treated as if you rented out on September 15th. So how much you will get in the first year, assuming you are a calendar year taxpayer? Yeah, 3.5 months. So what do you think is a really good time to buy all your equipment things? Earlier year or later year? Yeah, of course, and end of the year. Of course, if you buy it in December, you will have a half year convention. It seems like a little bit silly to buy it in January, right? So, however, that's why half quarter convention comes up. You cannot buy too much in the last quarter of the year. If you buy too much in the last quarter, which means the aggregate basis of the maker's property placed in service during the last quarter of the year exceeds 40% of the aggregate basis of maker's property placed in service during the year, they won't use the half-year convention. What they will make you do is a mid-quarter convention. For example, whatever you bought in the first quarter, we pretend you bought it on February 15th, the midway through the first quarter. So there is also like alternative makers. Generally, you must use general makers unless you are specifically required by law to use alternative makers, or you elect to use alternative makers. Alternative makers provide different methods and the recovery periods to use in figuring out depreciation deductions. So I will just skip these slides. Normally, alternative makers will not be tested. So now let's move on to the Section 179 election. Section Section 179 election is very important to depreciation because you can simply elect to deduct a huge amount right away. So the general rule is that a taxpayer can may elect to deduct rather than capitalize, or rather than capitalize and recover through makers or acres the cost of Section 179 property up to specified dollar limits. So the deduction is allowable in the year the property is placed in service. For example, in the year 2010, you can elect to deduct the full $500,000 in the first year. However, it's only for Section 179 property, and there's a definition I will talk later, and there are two limitations about it, which is dollar limitation and the business income limitation. So these two limitations were designed to ensure that Section 179 would only benefit small business. For example, in the year 2010, definition of small is less than or equal 2 million on the Section 179 property purchase. Definition of large is more than or equal 1.5 million on the Section 179 property purchase. For anywhere between, you phase out your benefit. For every dollar in that range, you take a dollar less than 500,000. Besides, the total cost you can deduct each year after you apply these two limitations is also limited to the taxable income from the active conduct of any trade or business during the year. Generally, you are considered to actively conduct a trade or business if you meaningfully participate in the management or operation of the trade or business. So here is the definition of 179 property. Generally, 179 property means any tangible property for which makers or acres deductions are allowable, that is Section 1245 property, and that is acquired by purchase for use in the taxpayer's active conduct of a trade or business. Also includes certain off-the-shelf computer software and the eligible qualified real property, but it does not include property ineligible for the investment tax credit. And now it's question of the day.
I will ask the question. Well, I'll ask you the questions. The question of the day. These were her questions. So you can have the microphone. The guys can give you. On January 2010, taxpayer purchases for $850,000 in cash and places in service new equipment exclusively for the business activity. The equipment is purchased from the manufacturer who is unrelated, right? This is the only purchase of Section 179 property made by the taxpayers during 2010. The equipment has a class life of 9 years. TP expects to use the equipment for 13 years. And TP estimates that the equipment will have a salvage value of $25,000 at the end of the period of use. Assume that the property qualifies under 168B1 and ignore 168B2. So they want you to focus just on the property and not the exceptions. All right. Now, before we go in, what are the trick questions in here? Why is the salvage value important?
It's trick you.
Is it important or not?
Not important for the application.
And the class life. Well, so here's your question. What is the maximum 179 deduction allowable in 2010, ignoring the 179B3? Apply 179 as it is in the Internal Revenue Code. So what was the 179 back then?
So the issue here is Section 179 election. If the taxpayers elect, what would be the maximum amount he's allowed to deduct in the first year? So the new equipment was placed in service 2010 and exclusively for use in the taxpayer's business activity. Section 179A applies. However, there are two limitations. So there are two limitations. One is the dollar limitation, another is like business income limitation. Based on these two limitations, we can figure out this table. Because the equipment is the only purchase of the Section 179 property made by taxpayer during 2010. And the taxpayer paid for $850,000, which is less than $2 million in the year 2010. So he can deduct $500,000 right away. So here's the answer.
Yep, so the conclusion was 500,000. Yep. All right, so the next question. All right, so now you've deducted 500,000. Right. How much can you still take depreciation, assuming you took the whole 500,000 in year, in 2010? Again, of course. Can you take it?
Yes.
Okay, so how much could you take it for the rest of 2000? She's going to tell you the formula.
There is a second important deduction related to depreciation, which is bonus depreciation. Bonus depreciation is applicable to any business. You can deduct 50% of brand new equipment placed in service immediately, and the rest 50% are subject to normal depreciation rules.
Question. We're assuming that the taxpayer elected. Well, they said maximum. So when they say maximum, you assume they take the elections to get to the maximum.
Okay. Yeah.
So we have to decide which applicable convention, applicable depreciation method, and applicable recovery period we should use. So first, generally we take the double declining balance method, and the salvage value should be treated as zero. Taxpayer bought the new equipment on January and placed it in service. It's the only Section 179 purchase he made during the year, so we should use half year convention. So the property has a class life of 9 years. Accordingly, it should be treated as a 5-year property, and it has a 5 years life. In calculating the depreciation, we need to follow the correct order. First, take Section 179 election, which we have already done in question 17. Second, bonus depreciation. Third, normal depreciation. So after taking Section 179 deduction of 500,000, the basis is 350,000. Taxpayer can take a 50 bonus depreciation deduction. So the basis after 50 bonus depreciation is 175,000. Now we move on to the normal depreciation, and we have to keep these four things in mind, which are declining balance method, double declining balance method, half year convention, 5 year applicable recovery period, and the salvage value should be treated as zero. So first year, the depreciation rate under the double declining balance is 2/5. The number of years in the recovery period, the result is 40%. So we multiply the basis of the property by the rate and apply the half year convention by multiplying 50%. So the depreciation under the double declining balance is 35,000. The depreciation rate under the straight line is 1/5. The result is 20%. Multiply the basis of the property by the 20% rate and apply the half year convention by dividing the result by 2. So depreciation under the straight line is 17,500. The double declining balance provides a larger deduction. So we deduct the 35,000 under the double declining method. we have to figure out after deduction, the basis is 140,000, and the remaining recovery period is 4.5 years because of half year convention. So this number is very important because we need to use it in order to calculate the straight line rate later. Now we move on to the second year. The depreciation rate on the double declining balance remains 40%. Depreciation under double declining balance is 56,000. So we pay attention to this number I mentioned before. So the rate on the straight line should be 1/4, which is about 22% because of half year convention we have already applied. So the depreciation under the straight line is about 31,000 because the double declining balance provides a larger depreciation. So you deduct the 56,000 under the double declining balance. So after the depreciation, the adjusted basis is 84,000 and the remaining recovery period is 3.5 years. So the third year is very similar to the second year. The depreciation rate under the straight line is about 29%, which is less than 40% under the double declining balance. We just need to focus on the depreciation rate. So we deduct 33,600 under the double declining balance. So after deduction, the basis is 50,400 and the remaining recovery period is 2.5 years. Now, the fourth year is very important because at this moment, the straight line provides an equal depreciation rate. So you switch to straight line and deduct 20,160. After deduction, the basis is 30,240 and the remaining recovery period is 1.5 years. So for the fifth year, in the fifth year, the depreciation under the straight line is 20,160. We only need to calculate the depreciation under the straight line. So after deduction, the basis is 10,080, and the remaining recovery period is 1/2 year. So in the last year, because there is less than 1 year remaining in the recovery period, the straight line depreciation rate should be 100%. After deduction, the adjusted basis is zero. So we depreciate all the way down to zero in the sixth year. Question 18 is asking about section 168 depreciation allowable in the first year. So the answer should be 175,000, which is the 50% bonus depreciation, and the 35,000, which is the normal depreciation under the double declining balance after applying half year convention. And
is that 210?
Oh yeah, sorry, it's 200. Yeah. And the question S19 is asking about what is the section 168 depreciation allowable in the second year. So we have already discussed it. The answer should be 56,000. Yeah. So I have used all my time. Yeah. So please welcome Karen.
How much time do we have left?
So one, I want to thank Reva, right? This is her first time. She's been working on doing these questions today that you guys have been reading, right? Eventually, any of you that want to get up here and do a question, yes, this is your class.
No, this is our class, so there's two things. A, can you put it in a larger print, or just have one regular and larger print?
What, in what?
In the printout that we have. Saying that, one of the good things about your slides is I use the slide flashcards.
Okay.
I bought four cases of paper. My house will be paper. Evan will go on a diet or she'll move in. You know? I'm not being funny.
I
seriously,
I will figure out a way to send you a larger set of...
So we have these bargains so that we could, you know, use it as that. Secondly, when we print out, I know mine is worse than other people's conditions, but if you could put it on a large fund, it is so much easier for people to read. Okay? We all invested in paper.
You see, that's the opposite of what people tell me. They don't want to print so much. I mean, that's the problem, right? Everybody doesn't want to print out lots of paper. That's why if you saw the margins went from 1 inch to 1/2 inch, because exactly that. The emails were, you know, try to keep the question of the day to 2 pages, right? That's as opposed to the longer explanations. So I'll, you know, I will send you larger fonts, but I can tell you that we're getting, the emails are contradictory from the class on what you guys want.
You cannot lose everybody.
Let's get back to the class.
All right, so there's one way, again. Okay. Now, what we covered tonight, right, are things that you see on most of the exams, and two, the ones that the people who send me practice answers have gotten mostly wrong. All right, so the reason we cover these are, one, they are tested, and two, it's the ones that we decided that you needed the most help on. If you look at what I sent you all of the questions, all of the code sections, and there's a hyperlink to the code section. Read the code sections and then read the rest of the chart. And if you guys have comments or questions, you know, just keep sending them. I know some of you are not shy. Now I just want to finish the last, maybe I'll just finish it quickly through you. But one, it's on every exam. Two, it is something that, I mean, most return preparers absolutely should know, and it's an inordinate number of examinations are done by the Internal Revenue Service because people are getting interest calculations incorrect. So let's talk about it. For the most part, interest is not deductible unless it meets a section of the code that makes it deductible, all right? So what does the code make deductible? You know, home mortgage interest. Two types of home mortgage interest are deductible, right? One, your acquisition indebtedness. And we're going to define acquisition indebtedness. And two, up to $100,000 of home equity indebtedness. All right. Now, both of these terms are terms that are defined in the code that may not mean exactly what you think they should mean. Acquisition indebtedness. So acquisition indebtedness is indebtedness incurred to acquire the property, right? But it also includes constructing or substantially improving a qualified residence. All right, so you buy a house, you take a second mortgage, and you use the proceeds to improve the house. Is that acquisition indebtedness or home equity indebtedness? It's acquisition indebtedness, right? Because it is used to substantially improve the qualified residence. Okay, so if you refinance a property,
no.
What is that? No, no, what? See, I like people who go to yes.
It's not acquisition indebtedness.
How about maybe?
It is, because it includes refinancing of acquisition indebtedness. Right, so, I mean, because if it didn't, right, and you bought a house, and then somebody said, we got this great new rate, you want to refinance the house, do you lose your home equity deduction because you refinanced? Are you still getting a 1098 from the bank? So you're going to tell the client, they're going to come in, hey, this 1098, you can't have this deduction because it's a different bank than you had last year. Yeah, any of you going to keep those clients? No. All right, refinances are still included in acquisition indebtedness. That's what I said. Just because common sense says that this is what the words should mean, doesn't mean anything. We're talking about the tax code. It's foreign language, okay? Home equity indebtedness, this is even gonna get more complicated, all right? Home equity indebtedness is indebtedness that's not acquisition indebtedness. Okay, but it's got to be secured by the house, right? And the home equity is limited to $100,000, all right? So home equity indebtedness is limited to $100,000. So let's go with the questions. TP buys a house. It's in Bergen County, so he has to pay $1.5 million. Okay? He puts $200,000, and then he gets a mortgage from the bank for $1.3 million. Right? As of January 1, right, how much of the principal on this first mortgage is deductible?
$1 million.
He's got $1.3 million mortgage. Can he deduct the interest on $1.3 million?
No.
But he's going to get a 1098 from the bank. No. And it says the whole $1.3 million. Can't we just slip it by? No. Right? The service has this nice little computer program, and they spit it out. And only the first million is deductible. Yes?
I'm just curious. Are they in the tax packages also?
What?
Like we have UltraTax and Thomas Brothers. And
I don't know the different programs, but you're supposed to be able to put in the number on the worksheet to say what's the total number. You get the million, and it does the allocation of the interest for you. I mean, I don't see you having to use a pencil and an override when you're doing the program. There's an underlying worksheet. Okay. Now, same facts. June 1st of the year, you reduce the principal amount of the mortgage down to 900, okay? You got $1.5 million in equity. So you're gonna borrow another $400,000 from the bank. All right, you're gonna give them a second mortgage. All right, so now you got your first mortgage of 900, you got a $400,000 second mortgage. I'm gonna take that 300 and I'm gonna add a game room. But then another 100, I gotta buy a boat.
That's right.
Right? You need the boat. It's the summer. It's the Jersey Shore.
Yeah.
All right. So I got $1.3 million. Can I deduct the whole thing?
No.
How come? Okay. So what can I deduct? All right. I got the first 900. Can I do the first 900?
Yes.
Okay. Now I got the second 400. What am I going to do with that?
Dissect it.
Take two of it. You're going to take
the... How come? It's only one mortgage. So who says I can only take 100 of the four?
No.
Okay. Who says I can take more than 100 of the four?
More than 100.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I'll explain to you why. First, what did the tax court rule? The tax court, when they looked at it originally, said you could only take the second 100, right? Because it wasn't acquisition indebtedness, right? The second mortgage. But there's a revenue ruling that came out that allows you to bifurcate, all right? So those of you who read the question of the day and it said suggested reading the revenue ruling, right? There was a tax court case that said you couldn't bifurcate. Now the IRS said, we're not going to follow. We're actually going to be more friendly to you than the tax court was.
Yeah, right.
So they did. It's a revenue ruling. I included it. You got a link. They want to help you. We're from the IRS. We want to help you.
Which way is the window?
So on that first mortgage, right? So we could take, we had room on the first mortgage. We weren't using our full million. So you're going to take, and we did the game room. Right? So you're gonna take part of the 400 and make it acquisition indebtedness because right. I used it for the game room. So I can go up to my full million now of acquisition indebtedness, right? But now I still got 300,000 left on that home equity, right? Where am I gonna put that? I'm still subject to my limit, right? So I got the 100,000. So I'm gonna use 100,000 of the second mortgage to as acquisition indebtedness, and I'm gonna use 100,000 of the 400 as home equity indebtedness. So now I get 200,000. So I'm up to a max of $1 million plus one, $1.1 million. Can I ever go above the $1.1 million?
No.
All right, so that's really the things you need to do. Yes, one last question. Yes.
Can you play games with the...
Play games? Play games? We're live! Do you know that?
If you have 900,000 at 6% and a 400,000 at, let's say, 5%.
Yeah.
Can you...
You can play, that's what the beauty of the revenue ruling. You can get up to the max of the $1 million, a million in acquisition indebtedness, and an extra 100 in home equity indebtedness. So if we can meet the definitions, we can deduct $1.1 million. You can't deduct more than $1.1 million. There are a lot of audits about people deducting everything, right? You guys are doing overrides. You're saying $2 million. All right, no, it happens. So then the one last question that I'm gonna let everybody go. Say we got, instead of, we got a married couple, we got two single people, all right? And they take a $2.2 million mortgage, right? How much can they deduct? Is it, do they have to split $1.1 million in half so each get 550? Or can we, because we decide not to get married, get to $2.2 million.
Per resident.
Who said per residence?
I did.
As a, who said per taxpayer?
Per taxpayer.
All right. What circuit are we in? Right. The tax court said per residence, and then that taxpayer appealed in the case called Sophie to the Ninth Circuit, who said the tax court was wrong, and it's per taxpayer. So if you're in the Ninth Circuit, and the answer would be you can take the full $2.2 million because it's per taxpayer, but the tax court originally said that it was per residence. So what that tells you, and both answers get you full credit on the exam. You put the code sections down and then explain. All right, if you know the table of the case, that would actually be great. You know, you'll get full credit. But there are, the way that the court has been grading the exams, if you show your reasoning, you could get full credit even for what might technically be a wrong answer, because it's tax, there's appeals. You know, there's some of these things, you know, can go either way. And so just look at the questions, reason them out, and you can still pass and get full credit for what could technically be a wrong answer.
So, all right. should we put tax courts, we know what number it is? Because that's in that place that I have, that's what we've been fighting about.
I don't grade the exam myself. I've only read the exams of people that have not passed on the first time and seen full credit or not. And it appears that if you put the right code section down, even if your answer is wrong, you've been getting partial credit. So I'm a big believer in the table of contents method of taking the exam. Always look at the table of contents first, put the code section, then write your answer, because then you're gonna get your partial credit and you make up for the fact that this is a marathon, not a sprint. It's a 4 hours of just writing and answering questions. So as we get closer to the exam, we'll talk about test-taking techniques, how to use the table of contents without going into the code sections, how to remember the questions of the day and the mnemonics. All right, thank you everybody for their attention. I want to thank everybody, you know, Reva, Emma, Karen, Jeff, everybody who put together, you know, the materials for tonight, and we'll see you next month at Evidence. You'll still be getting questions of the day. Start writing your own questions of the day, and I hope to see some of you at the barbecue.
I'm not.
Sophie didn't answer that question. Sophie didn't answer the question. Logic is, yes, that is not what the book is. Because they look at Mary Fun Joy, their reasoning suggests, no, their reasoning is that they're going to want to do something. Sophie, what feels more than night circuit? Tax rate is the tax rule was not given to widow to give you $550 each. It was a pro-residence limitation of the million bucks. So you need the second house to get it. Each taxpayer got $550. Who gets the 1.1? Residents or per tax? Sophie says per tax line, the taxpayer gets 1.1. So on their side, that same house is 2.2. So then we need to get 1.1 million.
Just think of that.
It's good fun.
I'll take one box.
higher.
So you get the benefit of the higher.
Jeff, did you hear me? I'll take one box.
You can't get around the employment tax law by calling everything I do.
They're not giving it to you as a gift, you're not family, they're giving it to you because you're providing a service.
So 25
is excluded. Remember, I said there's a section.
I'm the 25.
Right, so I'm on 25 because there's another section that excludes it. Then you got 25.
Okay.
Yeah. And they asked that on the exam. Those are questions. Ask email, can you turn all into email and then I try to turn it into questions?
Yeah, I made my husband
set up. Good. Different email just for your son.
Yes. So I sent it to Jeff.
Good.
Now I just gotta figure out how to Google it. I'm not a technical
person. I can't help that. That I don't know. But everything else, I would tell everybody. Set up their own separate Gmail account for their son.
So you can get the